Benvenuti all'Istituto Italiano di Cultura. Welcome to the Istituto Italiano di Cultura. Tonight the evening is successful, as you can see from the turnout, but it is successful because of the subject and also because of the speaker. This evening came about because of the cooperation with the Dominican Institute in Toronto. I was approached by Padre Francois, who is actually there, telling me that they were going to have, as a visiting scholar for this year, Dr. Marius Zerafa, who is a Dominican and who has studied a lot Italian Renaissance or Renaissance art. And in his many roles, I'm not going to talk about them because someone else will do, he has also had the adventure, the challenge, of being the person that had to retrieve a stolen picture of Caravaggio that you can see here and also here, St. Jerome. It's the only picture which has been signed by Caravaggio, if I'm not mistaken.
No, it's the beheading that has been signed.
Yes. And not,
not the St. Jerome.
Not this one. Okay, but in any case, this was the important painting in the Cathedral of La Valletta in Malta. Padre Zerafa is from Malta, he is Maltese, but he speaks such a wonderful Italian that I call him Padre, because he sounds more Italian to me than Maltese. So, well, I just want to introduce to you the person who is going to talk about him, to introduce him. It's Professor Darren Diaz. He's the head of the director of the Dominican Institute, and he's also a professor at the Faculty of Theology of the St. Michael's College. And so welcome and thank you to you and to your institute for having started this cooperation.
Thank you. It's nice to meet you. So before I introduce Professor Zerafa, I just wanted to make a note that Father Zerafa is scheduled to give a four-part lecture series at the Faculty of Theology at the University of St. Michael's College. And every Wednesday from 6 to 8, beginning on May 23rd. However, because of an overwhelming response, we've had to close registration. So he's generously agreed to offer a second series, a different series, every Friday from 6 to 8, beginning on May 25th, at the Faculty of Theology at the University of St. Michael's College. And Julie Katcher, who's at the back, she's raising her hand, has details in those pamphlets for you if you wish to attend. There is no charge for attending these, but we do cap registration because of the interest. So it's my pleasure then, even though Father Zerafa said keep it short before I go on, and I will, to introduce the 2012 Aquinas Visiting Scholar at the Faculty of Theology at the University of St. Michael's College. Born in Victoriosa, Malta, Father Zerafa joined the Dominican Order in 1945, and his formation included learning from the great theologians of the time, like Louis-Dominique Chenu, Victor White, and Gary Gulagrange, and in the company of fellow students, like the Canadian Dominican Jean-Marie Chiari. And after studies in Malta, Rome, and Black Friars, Oxford, Father Zerafa completed a doctorate in the Angelicum, not in the area of art, but in social sciences, and specifically on the philosophical thought of Karl Marx. A surprise for priests in the 1950s, but maybe not a surprise for the socialist Prime Minister of Malta, Sir Paul Wafa. And after his doctorate, Marius returned to study, this time to study art at the University of Rome and at London University. A set of unforeseen but perhaps fortunate circumstances took him from the Prior of San Marco in Florence to take up a position at the Malta Museums, where he rose to the rank of curator and eventually director. During his tenure, he established the Museum of Fine Arts in Valletta. And in 1986, as director, he masterminded the retrieval of Caravaggio's Saint Jerome, which Adriana spoke about. And he tells the tale of this adventure in his book, The Caravaggio Diaries, which are for sale this evening. In the book, Father Zerafa reflects on the adventure of retrieving the Caravaggio, commenting that it was easier to deal with the Italian mafia who had ransomed the painting than with the Vatican. As director of the Malta Museums, Dr. Zerafa has become known as an expert of the Baroque era, obviously, and it's ironically perhaps his least favorite era aesthetically. He still prefers the Renaissance or the Gothic. And his passion for contemporary art is reflected in his continued involvement with the Malta Arts Biennale, of which he is co-founder and current vice president. He continues to serve the church as chairman of the Archdiocese of Malta's Commission on Sacred Art, and he spends 1 month each year as confessor at Santa Maria Maggiore. So if anyone here has reserved six, in addition to traveling widely throughout Europe and lecturing, Dr. Zerafa is a faculty member at the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas in Rome. He is associate of the Royal Historical Society London, the member of the Accademia Tiberna of Rome, and a Chevalier of de l'Ordre des Arts et des Lettres in France. Father Zerafa is an artist in his own right, a friend and mentor to many in his field. He has dedicated his career to the noble task of highlighting the importance of art and aesthetics for religious, cultural, and human development. So please help me welcome this evening Father Zerafa for his lecture.
Dominican solidarity. It's great to be. I promise you I didn't pay him, all right? Now, I want to keep this as informal as possible. It's a long subject, so I'll be as brief as I can. What I propose to do is to give a short account of the life of Caravaggio, then, second point, his contribution to art, then we'll see his major works. I'm trying to say a picture is worth a thousand words. Then I'll tell you something, I'll tell you something about how I managed to get the stolen Caravaggio back at the risk of my life. I got to know later that they paid £5,000 to kidnap me during the exchange. That's very flattering. And then I hope that this is the most important part of the lecture. I hope to have some questions at the end, because it's only then that we can really establish a contact and make sure that we are on the same wavelength, okay? So briefly, speaking about Caravaggio, Michelangelo Merisi, born in Caravaggio in 71, baptized in Milan. As a boy, his father died when he was young in the famous plague in Milan, described so well by Manzoni. So he was sent with an artist, Simon Peterzano, to learn his trade, as was the custom in those days. We still have the Latin contract. The Simon Peterzano prided himself on being a pupil of Titian. This is very, very important, because technically Caravaggio is Venetian. He paints the way the Venetian did by using glazes and scumbling and so on. Unless you understand this, it's very difficult to appreciate the technique of Caravaggio. In certain pictures, you see Giorgione in the background. So that's his technique. He studied for 4 years with Simon Peterzano, then went down to Rome, worked for various artists. He stayed with a Monsignor, who gave him salad for breakfast, salad for lunch, and salad for supper, and he's gone down in history as Monsignor Insalata. He worked with Cavalier d'Arpino, and finally he came to the notice of an important Cardinal Del Monte, who obtained for him some very important commissions
starting with the life of Saint Matthew in the church of San Luigi dei Francesi. And there he did his first really important work. Okay, that is the National Church of the French, and for them the conversion of Saint Matthew in some way reflected the conversion of Henry IV, who had just returned to the church. So it had a great significance. Anyhow, he got, while in Rome, he got involved quite often with the police. He had a very rich criminal record. At least 7 times he was taken to court. On one occasion, because he offended a fellow artist, Baglione. This Baglione had got a medal from the Pope, and Caravaggio didn't approve of it. So he wrote a very crude poem about him, and made sure that everybody read it. And della medaglia indegno sei e dell'arte vituperio. Okay? And the interesting thing is that what we know about Caravaggio comes from a biography by Baglione. That's why we've got to take it with a pinch of salt. Because even when he's praising Caravaggio, he doesn't do it so willingly. When he talks about the calling of St. Matthew, which was an unqualified success, he would say, people praised it because people judge with their ears, not with their eyes. So that's Baglione for you, all right? Then there's Bellori and there's Sandra. And whenever he's described, he's always described as genio di Roma, the genius of Rome, as a pictore egregio, the famous artist, the illustrious artist, but they always add mente stravagantissima, which means he was slightly funny, okay? So that we have to keep in mind. So he got commissions from churches. He painted in San Luigi, he painted in Santa Maria del Popolo, he painted in Sant'Agostino, but he was always being taken to court for one thing or another. At one time he was playing alla maglia, sort of tennis. He fought a duel and killed a young man, Ranuccio Tommasoni, who belonged to an important family. So he was outlawed from Rome, not just exiled. Anybody could cut off his head and get a prize, okay? So he fled from Rome, he went to Naples, kept on painting. He was always protected by important families because he had connections with the Colonna, the Doge, and so on. And finally, he went down to Malta to join the Order of St. John. He did that, obviously, because the knights were always on the lookout for artists to decorate their churches, but mainly because he thought that by becoming a Knight of Malta, a religious order, he would get pardon from the Pope and he could return to Rome. While in Malta, he spent 1.5 years, he did his novitiate there, like any religious order, and he produced his great masterpiece, The Beheading of St. John, which he offered, you know, to become a knight, you have to pay a sum of money, but artists usually presented a painting. And it's the only one that he signed, and he signed it with Frater, brother, like a Dominican brother, Frater Michelangelo. Okay, after that he got into trouble again, and recently authors tried to find out what he had done, because anyhow, recently they discovered that in fact he had quarreled with a certain Coppini, who played the organ in the cathedral, knocked down his door and attacked him at night. And the other knights with him were carrying pistols. And this was forbidden. They could carry swords, but not pistols. So he was imprisoned while his case was being studied. And his great sin was that he escaped from prison and left the island without permission. For a religious, until recently, a friar leaving the convent without permission would be considered a fugitivus, okay? So that was his greatest sin, and we still have the document in Malta, expulsum fuit tampam membrum fetidum et putridum. He was cut off from the order as a stinking member. Okay, considering that a year earlier, the Grand Master had asked for special permission from the Pope to accept him into the order because he had committed a crime. They said, just for this one time. And the Vatican said, okay, for this one time, you can accept him as a knight, okay? And there's a document where the Grand Master says, just as Greece honored Apelles, so Malta wants to honor Caravaggio. A year later, they say, cut him off as a sinking member, right? So he went back to Sicily, where he had an artist friend, Mario Miniti. He painted four pictures in Sicily. One of them, unfortunately, a lovely nativity painted for San Lorenzo in Palermo, was stolen by the mafia about 40 years ago. I'm lucky I saw it when I was a student. And they know it's in the hands of the mafia, but it has never come back. Probably the same mafia that tried to steal ours. Anyhow, so he painted four pictures in Sicily, went up to Naples, painted other pictures, and was trying to get back to Rome. All this time, the cardinals, his friends, were trying to get pardon from the Pope. And he was carrying with him some pictures, which I'll show you, showing himself as Goliath, asking for pardon so he would return to Rome, which was obviously the place for an artist to be. Okay, when he was at Port Ercole, he was arrested by mistake. The boat left with his paintings. He walked up and down on the shore and died, somebody said, miserably as he had lived. All right? Recently, the book came out claiming that he was killed by the Knights of Malta and so on. But I'll show you a document where it says that he was, in fact, looked after in a hospital, and that he morto cristianamente, which means that he received the last sacraments. Okay, now I'll show you these documents. So that's as regards his short, eventful life. As regards his contribution to art, it's a question of, first of all, he was a great realist. A great realist. When he was taken to court by Baglione, and they asked him, why don't you look upon him as a valiant uomo? He said, for me, a valiant uomo is somebody who can paint reality. But it doesn't mean that he was just a photographer. There's a famous book, book by Professor Calvesi, called Le Realtà del Caravaggio, where he shows that he's not just an artist who can paint realistically details and so on, but in his paintings he puts other realities, psychological, profound religious realities, as we'll see. So those are the realities of Caravaggio. Now he did this, I think, if I have to sum him up in a one word, it would be immediacy. When you see a painting by Caravaggio, it catches you because of the strong contrast, okay, the way that he doesn't waste his energy in detail. When I take my students in Rome to San Luigi dei Francesi, you watch tourists passing by the other paintings, all these Baroque angels and clouds and so on, and they don't even stop. When they come to Caravaggio, they are frozen on the spot, okay? And he achieves this by a special use of light. Every artist has used light and shade. Even if we are painting a football, you've got to use highlights and shadows, okay? Leonardo brought in this sfumato, the way that the outlines are misty, are lost. In the case of Caravaggio, he brought in this strong contrast. We call it the luce di cantina, a cellar light, because he's supposed to have painted in a dark room. There was a hole in the ceiling, We know at one time his landlady protested, obviously, because he had a hole in the ceiling, and he would have a strong light coming on the main part of the picture, and that created not only composition, but drama, and quite often the ray of light would, in religious painting, would signify, as we see, the light of grace. So the luce di cantina is immediacy. These are the contributions to art of Caravaggio. He seems to want to bring in the spectators into the area of the painting. The Sapere Thermos in London and in the National Gallery, you can see that his intention is to make the spectator feel as if he's participating in the Sapere Thermos. We'll see this in the picture. So I've given you a very brief account of his life, a very brief description of his his contribution to art. As far as the technique is concerned, it was rather strange that he never produced or hardly ever produced any drawings. No drawings by Caravaggio exist. Most probably, his technique was obviously very Venetian, but what he did, I tried it myself and it works, he would have his canvas painted red, the Venetian red, and then over the red he would have this sort of red. Over that he would have a black transparent glaze to obtain a rich brown, not a chocolate brown, but a very rich dark brown. And then with the back of his brush, he would scratch the outlines. In fact, in most of his painting, you can still see the way that he scratched the ears. And then he would start painting. If he didn't like the result, he would just paint all over again. All right, I'll show you a painting at San Luigi dei Francesi. There's an X-ray, so you know what's underneath. And he changed the whole composition, he painted a completely new picture. So that was something that his contemporaries couldn't understand, because for the old normal artist, art is the expression of a concept which you put on a piece of paper, you perfect it, then you square it up and you transfer it to canvas. Caravaggio just painted and just sort of, people liked it, otherwise he would just paint it all over again. Okay, now I think we can see some of his pictures. This is how contemporaries saw Caravaggio. It's by Leone, a lovely pastel. But I'm more interested in showing you how he saw himself. And you see this in some of his paintings. For instance, this is at San Luigi dei Francesi, the martyrdom of St. Matthew, and he put himself among the spectators. A very tragic face, as you can see. Yes. Another picture, this is quite interesting. This is a very late picture. Obviously, every artist would love to paint himself as David. Caravaggio painted himself as Goliath, because this was a picture which he was carrying with him to take to the Borghese to ask for pardon. And obviously here he's showing, he's begging for pardon. There are three initials here, three letters, H-U-M, and they've been interpreted as humilitas omnia vincit. Okay, humility conquers all. So here he was obviously trying to present this to the Medici, saying, look, I'm guilty, forgive me, get me a papal pardon so I can return to Rome. Yes? This is a, no. This is a, an even more interesting, this is a picture discovered recently, about 10 years ago, in a Jesuit's common room. It's the taking of Christ in the garden. They thought it was a hontost. They took it because there was another version of it in Odessa. They took this to, it was restored by Sergio Benedetti, and it came out so lovely that now this is accepted as the original. It's on permanent loan to the Dublin National Gallery. So here you've got this lovely portrait of Christ, this sort of Judas and Christ, the way that Giotto used to place them, these lovely hands here, the reflection on the armor. What is very interesting that here you have a self-portrait of Caravaggio holding the lantern to the face of Christ. I think that's quite, and you see the effect of the reflection of light on the armor. And this Saint John rushing out of the picture, probably you know the Picasso at one moment did something very, very similar. So that's Caravaggio there participating in this event, and there's this meaning of sort of holding the lantern to recognize Christ. Yes? Another lovely painting is this. This is the last painting he did. It's in a bank in Naples. It's the Santo Sola. And again, there's this lovely effect of light. And here at the back, you have a self-portrait of Caravaggio participating in this martyrdom. So that's I think that's quite interesting about the psychology of the artist who is so much a part of his work. Yes? Now, okay, this is just an etching, yes? And this is one of the many copies. Oh, this exists in the Bishop's Palace in Indina, and at one time they wanted to pass it as a Caravaggio. Okay. Yes? Now, this is his first work. We know that as soon as he went down to Rome, he spent some time in hospital. So this is the sick Bacchus, a self-portrait. The usual story is that he had malaria. Nowadays they think that he was probably kicked by a horse because he was in the hospital della Consolazione where they treated wounds and not malaria, okay? So already you have the table leading in to create depth in the picture. Another Bacchus at the Uffizi is quite lovely, beautifully modeled. And you see already the reflection in the water. You've got this very realistic rendering of the still life. I mean, remember, at that time, Dutch art was becoming popular in Italy. And he was competing with the realism of Dutch artists. Yes? This is interesting. This is in Milan, and obviously it's not just a still life. This is what we call a memento mori. It was very common with Dutch paintings to have a morality picture. A girl looking into the mirror and there's a skeleton. Or even a kokoschka, that is, with a cigarette, with smoke representing all that lives must pass, passing from nature to eternity. So the idea was that that fruit is lovely, but then there's a rotten apple. So everything that exists must have an end, right? A memento mori. Remember that thou must die, right? Yes. Again, another morality picture. You see the drama, the open lips and so on. This is the young man in love. He's catching the rose, which was a symbol of love, but there's something ramaro. There's a snake, whatever it is, underneath. So it's the dangers of love. You're attracted, but then you regret it, okay? And then the effect of light is the light that is modeling the figure. Yes? Again, this is more obvious already. It's the Baroque idea of ikket nunc, catching the moment, right? You all know the David by Michelangelo. It's very strong, but it's got an inner strength. It's in repose. I mean, Michelangelo said, a good statue can roll down the hill, okay? Now, when you get to the Baroque sculptor like Bernini, and you see the David and the Borghese, and it's a self-portrait, and he's represented at that very moment when he's letting off the stone. Right, the Baroque had to catch the moment. So here you've got the famous story of the Medusa. You looked at it, you were turned into stone and so on. So Perseus went down, cut off the head, and the blood is spurting out. You get those, it's like the shrimp by Munch, you know? The open mouth, the eyes and so on. And this is concave, convex, but it looks concave, so the head comes up. And it's all an effect of light. This was given to the Archduke of Florence for his armor, and contemporaries describe how people would go in and get a shot because it was so very realistic. Yes? And this is very unusual for Caravaggio. It's a lovely painting. This is at the Palazzo Doria. It's based on one of the four Gospels. They rest on the flight to Egypt. The angels came down to minister to the Holy Family and so on. This part is obviously very Venetian. That could be a Giorgione, a lovely light, lovely colors and so on. This angel could almost be a Botticelli. It's really lyrical. There's the tender mother and child. There's Saint Joseph holding up the music score for the angel to play on his violin. Interesting. The music here isn't just a squiggle as you usually have in painting. That music has been read and it can be played. It's the Song of Songs and so on. And it's real music, contemporary music. Okay? Yes. This is one of the concerto. This is in the Metropolitan Museum. There's a self-portrait of Caravaggio, and there's Mario Minniti, the other artist from Sicily. If you see this lovely drapery, I don't know whether you can see it here, it's worked in the Venetian way. It's a lovely red, transparent glazes, one on top of the other, and then what they call scumbling, passing the dry brush over the highlights to get that sort of realism that you have in Titian and that you have in Venetian artists, okay? Yes. This is a lovely boy or a girl, at one time it was called, playing the lute. This is at the Hermitage, a lovely still life, a lovely figure, the table and the instruments creating depth in the picture. This was so popular that he did a replica, which is at the Metropolitan of New York. Okay, slight changes, but it's got exactly the same outline. All right? Yes. This is a lovely painting. This is in Fort Worth. It's the car chops. Again, it's sort of it's warning young men against the evil of play because they are cheating. He's got a card hidden, and he's telling him, okay, he's got the glove stone because that was used to recognize certain cards that had some special marks, so he can cheat and so on. But that's a lovely painting, and we know of a lot of copies of this because it must have been extremely popular. Yes. Again, this is the Louvre. It's the fortune teller. This was taken by Bernini when he went up to Paris to the Louvre. He wanted to design a facade for the Louvre. Actually, he was coming to Malta to do St. John's, but he said, I can't because I'm going to Paris. And he designed the Louvre, but they didn't approve of the Baroque. So now we have the columns by a French sculptor. So he presents, again, this is a morality picture. The gypsy is reading his hand. At the same time, she's slipping off his ring. Okay? And there's another version of this in Rome, in the National Museum, okay? So you see the light, you see the lovely fabrics here, and the morality behind it, lesson behind it, yes? This is in the Thyssen collection in Madrid. It's a portrait of his girlfriend, it's St. Catherine, yes? Look at the lovely texture. This is in Detroit, quite about 40 years ago. Again, I wish I could show you this detail, this sleeve. It's pure Venetian technique. You can see the satin, you can see the sheen on the material. It's beautiful. And the famous mirror that he had, that he uses in his paintings recently, the Hockney came out with the idea that he used the camera oscura. You know, some artists definitely used lenses and so on. We know that Canaletto definitely did. Vermeer probably did. I don't think it applies to Caravaggio, okay? But it's one of the modern theories. Yes? Now this is the this is sacred work, the work in San Luigi. He had produced a Saint Matthew, which was better than this one, I think, but they had refused it because he represented the old man almost as an illiterate person with the angel moving his fingers. So they removed that. It was taken to Berlin and unfortunately it was lost in the last war. Instead of that, he painted the Saint Matthew with the angel, probably St. Matthew, the Gospel of St. Matthew starts with the genealogy of Christ. So probably that is why the angel is saying Jacob begot, okay, the genealogy of Christ. Okay, but you see, it's an ordinary person just sort of writing, and we'll see the previous painting. This was the original painting. It was absolutely lovely, I think. But you see, they thought, remember that the Council of Trent had put great emphasis on art. They wanted art to be the ancilla theologia, to serve theology. It had insisted very much on truth to the scriptures. If the scriptures said there were 12 apostles, you had to represent 12 apostles. You know, the case of Veronese, who painted the Last Supper, and he included monkeys and German soldiers and so on. So the Inquisition took him up, and the Inquisition wasn't strong in Venice, so he cut off. He said, you know, we artists, we are like boys, we are slightly funny. But he had to change the name. In fact, that painting now is called A Feast in the House of Levi. Right? The Council of Trent insisted very much, it was the emphasis of the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius to represent reality. The Council of Trent insisted on truth to nature and insisted very much on what it called decoro. A number of pictures that we will see were removed from churches because the authorities thought, rightly or wrongly, that he was sinning against decoro. You couldn't have bare feet, okay? Okay, so next. So this is his first masterpiece. This is in the Church of San Luigi, the National Church of the French. As I said, it would have a special meaning for them because their king had just returned to the faith. You've got Saint Matthew, who was a tax collector. So he plays him in a tavern. He's counting the money. Christ comes in, there's a window, but the light does not come through the window. The window is a cross. The light comes from above Christ. Christ makes the gesture, it's similar to the creation of Adam by Michelangelo in the Sistine Chapel. We know that when he painted the figure of Christ here, later he added on top of it Saint Peter, probably because of the theological discussions at the time to emphasize that grace comes through the sacraments, through the church. This is obviously the light of grace. In the papal bull receiving Henry IV back into the church, the Pope speaks of a ray of light that passes through the darkness. So that's the you know. Okay, so here you've got these young men in contemporary dress. Probably the idea is that grace didn't just come 2,000 years ago, but it's something that can happen even in our own lifetime. All right? So this is the side of the chapel. You've got to see it from the side, and really comes out three-dimensionally. On the other side, there's the mountain of St. Matthew, and here we have the self-portrait of Caravaggio among the spectators. Now, try to remember this picture because I'm going to show you what's underneath. Okay, yes? That's an X-ray. When you take an X-ray of a painting, you know what's underneath because white paint is made of lead. So an X-ray of a painting shows what's underneath, just like when you have an x-ray and the bones and your evil conscience, it all shows, okay? So you'll notice the executioner is here, originally was here, the young man is up there, the altar boy is here, and there was a young man waiting to be baptized, okay? So you'll notice that it wasn't just a little pentimento, which all artists have, but a complete reworking of the composition, all right? Yeah. Another work he did in Rome is this conversion of St. Paul. Obviously, he was so interested in light, so he had this surface. I sometimes refer to this as the conversion of the horse, because he gave so much importance. But like the Impressionists, his idea was to have a surface to take light. You remember Renoir, when he wanted to have a girl to look after his son, he advertised for a girl and he said, a girl whose skin takes the light well. So all the portraits by, all the nudes by Renoir, it's Gabrielle, and he chose her because the Impressionists were interested in light, right? The facade of the Cathedral of Rouen, so on. So that's the idea in Caravaggio, yes? And this was a previous conversion of St. Paul, which wasn't accepted. It went to Spain. It's far more complicated. There's a Christ that comes down from heaven, and there's an angel sort of holding him back. Right? Whereas the other one represents the conversion of St. Paul after he had fallen off the horse. Yes. This is a lovely sacrifice of Isaac. It's in the Uffizi. He's sacrificing his son, and at that very moment the angel holds his hand. A very lovely landscape here. It could be Giorgione. Lovely light, very, very Venetian. Yes. And this is the famous Supper at Emmaus in the National Gallery. It's one of the most interesting episodes in the Gospel. After the resurrection, there were the two disciples discussing the death of Christ and so on, and Christ came up and joined them and explained the scriptures. And they said, come in because the night is approaching. And they recognized him in the breaking of the bread. So here you've got the two disciples, the pilgrim with the shell. Critics usually criticize Caravaggio for having this hand as big as this one. It should be smaller because it's in the distance. I believe that he did that on purpose because he wants to place you as a spectator somewhere here. So you see the equidistance of the two hands. The food is practically falling off the table. I think that's another trick he uses, that with the St. Jerome as well. The idea of immediacy. And what about, there's this man with his elbow jutting out with this patch, very cleverly done, so it practically comes out of the picture. The table that creates depth, this hand of Christ in foreshortening, the waiter here that casts a shadow behind the face of Christ, so the head really comes out. He was criticized for having presented a Christ as a young man. Nowadays, we know that in fact, in early Christianity, in the catacombs, Christ was always represented as a young man. So again, the authorities were wrong, and Caravaggio was right. Okay. Now, 7 years later, he did this other supper at Emmaus. This is the Brera in Milan. It's practically a monochrome, a lovely, lovely face of Christ. It's not dramatic, it's more meditative. The same people, the same position, but it doesn't have the contrast of colors and the drama, but it's another great masterpiece, yes? And this is one of the great masterpieces. This is in Potsdam. The Incredulity of St. Thomas. Very dramatically, Christ gets hand of St. Thomas and puts it into his side, and you get the other apostles focusing their attention on this area. That's Caravaggio, the immediacy, the drama, and the profound, in spite, or perhaps because of his naughty life, he could produce very profound religious works, right? Not the shilly-shally sort of superficial, sugary works that were current at the time. He really goes deeply into an act of faith as in the credulity of St. Thomas. Yes? This is interesting. This is in Berlin. It's Love Triumphant. He had no respect for other artists when he was taken to court. He said something shocking. He said, "I don't care for Apelles, I don't care for Raphael." To say that at that time was really shocking. He said, "Because nature has given me all these masters," and he pointed to the people around him, which means that, like the Impressionists, they didn't want to see nature through the eyes of the masters, but he wanted to see nature with his own eyes. Okay, I don't care for Raphael. So the only artist that he respected was Michelangelo. And you'll see that a number of times he borrowed from, and this is a case in point. It's a lovely study of instruments and so on, but it's obviously one of the Nudi by Michelangelo in the Sistine Chapel. Okay, yes. This is a lovely, lovely painting. This is the famous Madonna dei Pellegrini. It's meant to represent the Madonna in the house of Loreto. Two pilgrims come and this figure comes to life. Actually, it's a portrait of his friend, of his girlfriend, Lena, la donna di Caravaggio che stava a Piazza Navona. Okay, so she comes to life and he's got an interesting composition, a diagonal. This was severely criticized because they had bare feet. They thought that was against the decorum insisted upon by the Council of Trent. Nowadays we know that in fact that was the idea of St. Philip Neri, of Cardinal, what's his name, to represent poverty and humility. Okay, the pilgrims that practically touch the child and it comes to life. This is a lovely technical achievement, the rich material done in a Venetian way, yes? And this is obviously a great masterpiece. This was painted for the Church of St. Philip Neri. Now it's in the Vatican. Again, it's the Christ, the dead Christ of the Pietà of Michelangelo, the same hand. This is most probably a portrait of Michelangelo Buonarroti, with his elbow jutting out. It's very interesting. It's got this tombstone at eye level. It juts out of the picture. So the rest of the group towers above us, okay? The religious connotation, a plant growing in the tomb to represent the afterlife. Here you get Nicodemus. You get Mary Magdalene. We see that girl again in the death of the Virgin. You have the Orante. The early Christians represented the person in prayer with their hands, sit in the catacombs, always with their hands open. This was a very important painting. There's a copy of it by Rubens. He left this part out. And there's a watercolor, believe it or not, by Cézanne. Okay? And this and Cézanne is incident. Okay. I'll come to that. Yes, okay. Now this is one of the many, he painted many young men as St. John and many old men as St. Jerome. This is the St. Jerome at the Galleria Borghese. It's a lovely study of an old man. It's practically two parts, the skeleton. He was translating the Bible and the hand combines the two parts of the picture. Yes. And again, another painting that was refused. This was painted for the Palafrieri, those men who used to carry the Pope on his chair. Okay, Saint Anne was their patron saint, and obviously they expected a glamorous figure. Instead, he painted this old hag, a lovely portrait of the Madonna. Again, it's Lena. It's a lovely, lovely portrait. And it's the old prophecy, "I will raise a woman and she shall crush your head." And he was very careful to have the feet of Christ on the feet of the Virgin, crushing the head. This was painted for the Vatican. It was thrown out. Now it's in the Galleria Borghese. Yes? And I'm sorry. Let's see. This was the greatest tragedy of his life. This was the death of the Virgin, painted for a Carmelite church in Trastevere. Then somebody, he obviously had many enemies, spread the rumor that he had used a prostitute as a model that had committed suicide by jumping into the Tiber. So obviously, until then, they didn't paint the death of the Virgin, but the Dormitio Virginis, okay? Whereas here you've got this girl with bare feet, so it was, you've got this girl, we've seen her already as Mary Magdalene in the other painting. This painting was thrown out of the church. It was bought by Rubens. It was exhibited in Rome for all the artists to see. Then it went to Milan, ended in the Royal Collection. Now it's at the Louvre, and it's considered a great, great masterpiece. Yes, there's a copy of it by Poussin, of all people. Poussin is famous for having said he was the one that really didn't appreciate Caravaggio, and he said Caravaggio came into the world to destroy painting. Being a classical artist, he just couldn't accept it. He still made a copy of the death of the Virgin. Yes? Now we go back to our country. He came to Malta, became a knight. So this is the Grandmaster Vignacourt, who wanted to receive him as a knight, who wrote to the Pope, to the Vatican, to ask for a dispensation to accept him as a knight. He said, for this one time, and there's a letter I'll show you from the Vatican saying, okay, for this one time. So he accepted him, and he painted his portrait. So there's the Grandmaster, this armor we still have at the armory in Malta, with the page boy. This, the red tunic that the knights used to wear, red with the white cross. This painting is now at the Louvre in Paris. It's quite a great painting. Yes. Another painting that he did in Malta was for Cavalier Martelli, who was a knight in Malta. This was discovered by Mina Gregori about 20 years ago. At first they thought it was a portrait of the Grand Master. Now we know it's Cavalier Martelli. He took it with him back to Florence, and it's now at the Pitti Gallery in Florence. That's the knight with the eight-pointed cross of the order. The head is lovely. It's worked very freely. It looks almost like a Franz Hals, right? Like the Laughing Cavalier's one. Yes. Now this is another painting that he did in Malta, the Sleeping Putto. It's not just a picture. This was, again, a morality picture. When somebody joined the Knights of Malta, it was like joining an order. So the idea would be no more wine, women, and song. And this was a sort of thing to say, look, Cupid is asleep, okay? No more, you just have to live. So they had this as a memento mori, as a morality picture. This was so, the owner of this, a knight of Malta, took it back to Florence. And if you ever go to Florence, you go to Santa Croce, you face the church. On this side, there's the palace of Cavalier d'Alata, who had this. And he had it painted on the facade of the palace. You can still see it. There's a copy of this painted on the facade. He wanted to make sure that everybody in Florence knew that he had a Caravaggio. Okay? This is at the Uffizi, and at the back there's written Dipinto a Malta 1608. Okay, lovely modeling. It's not a pleasant picture at all. It's a Cupid, all right? It's the god of love, but once you've joined the order, forget it, okay? Yes. And this is his great masterpiece. This is the picture which he did. It's bigger than this room. It's the picture which he did in the year that he spent as a novice, and instead of giving a sum of money, probably presented this. It's the execution of St. John, who was the patron saint of the knights. His head has been cut off, and the executioner is finishing off the job with his knife, which was called the Misericordia. Okay, all the attention is focused. It's a quite a classical composition, recorded by the semicircle there. This is very likely painted. Contemporaries say that it's not painted at all. It's just the preparation, just the brown color that I mentioned. Whereas here, you get a very thick impasto. Originally in the cathedral, there was a window, so the natural light would correspond with the light on this, the event on the stage. This is obviously a stage. This was painted the same year that Shakespeare wrote King Lear, okay? So there's this drama on the stage. There's this old lady, probably the best part of the painting. She's like a Greek chorus. She's interpreting what's happening on the stage, okay? And you get the other prisoners, so the attention, although it's, the action is not on the in the center, all the attention is focused on the head of St. John. And this, instead of presenting St. John wearing camel skin, here he's wearing the sacrificial lamb skin, okay? And why did Caravaggio sign this painting? One reason may be that he identified himself with St. John because he too was under a sentence of death. And this is the only one that is painting that is signed. And characteristically enough, it's signed with the blood coming out of the neck of St. John, and there's a nephew, Frater Michelangelo. Okay? I'll answer questions on this later on if we have time. Yes? Now this is the subject of my story. This is the same Jerome. Again, painted for a knight, Malaspina, who then left it at St. John's. It's a pyramidal composition. St. Jerome lived in the desert, he was translating the Bible, so there's the stable leading in. He meditated on the cross. You see the crucifixes should fall off the table. There's the skull that he meditated on and the stone that he beat himself with, and this is the crest of the knight Malaspina. Okay? Yes. Another painting which he most probably did in Malta is this Annunciation, which was then sold to some French people, and it's now in Lyon. Yes? Now, these are copies of St. Jerome because it was quite popular. Yes. Another copy, yes. This is how I try to copy it, painting it red, all right, doing the outlines and putting the highlights. Yes, and this is the result. It's not red yet, but you see that's the effect, how you can produce a Caravaggio, not a Caravaggio, obviously. Now, let's go back to serious works. These are the ones that he did in Sicily. You'll notice that old woman here. In some books you read that he couldn't paint without a model. That's not true. He had a very good visual memory. He painted that old lady in Malta, and I don't think he took it with him to Sicily. So obviously he had this image of this old lady, and he reproduces it in the burial of Santa Lucia. Notice how his style is changing. The color is becoming more fragmented, and you can already see Rembrandt here. Okay, Rembrandt has got to Caravaggio through a shiner. Okay, yes. Resurrection of Lazarus, yes. This is the one in Palermo, which was stolen by the mafia. Okay, recently, the most recent news about it is that somebody, one of the pentiti, said that it had been sort of folded up and placed in somewhere and probably was eaten up by rats and so on and so forth. It's a pity because I remember it. I went to Palermo on purpose. It's a lovely, lovely work with St. Lawrence and St. Francis and so on. Anyhow, yes? And this is one of the last works. It's the Incredulity of St. Thomas, St. Peter and the Metropolitan. And it's quite interesting. You get, you know, St. Peter. It was cold, so he sheltered near the fire. So there are sparks of fire. I don't think you can see them here, but in the painting it's quite effective. Yes, I'm told that. And this is the last work, the Saint Ursula in Naples. Saint Ursula was a common subject, you have it in Venice and so on, but this is a very novel way of interpreting the king who's killing the girl that refused him, and Caravaggio is present. Yes? Yes? Now these are documents, that's the baptism and certificate, we've got to this. Yes, very helpful. Yes, this is what they asked him when he was taken to court, yes. This is his signature, Frate Michelangelo, yes. And these are letters that we have in Malta to get him into the order. Yes, come on, yes. Okay, if you're interested, I can explain, but for the moment, you've got to accept them on faith. Okay, this is when they're, and this is the death certificate. If it's valid, it disproves what has been written recently, yes. Now, we come to this story of the stolen Caravaggio. In 84, the last day of the year, when there was only one guy in attendance, three people went in, they put a chain across the entrance, work in progress, they lowered the heavy frame, and they cut the canvas off the stretcher. Okay? An American tourist came and she went to complain because there was this chain, and the curator obviously got the shock of his life. And now that was in 84, yes? Yes, this is how it looked. That's the empty frame, yes? Now, for 2 years we heard absolutely nothing and we had given up the painting for loss. 2 years later, a young man came to the prior, knocked at the door, and he said, I've got a letter for you, personal. Inside there was a tape and another envelope, and on the small envelope there was written, do not open this envelope before you have played the tape. Obviously the first thing I did, I opened the envelope, and inside there was a Polaroid picture of the painting cut off the stretcher with a coffee pot on it. I rushed downstairs, but this man had disappeared. So I did a small sketch to remember what he looked like, and I played the tape. It was quite terrible. He said, we've got the Caravaggio, if you're interested. We won't have a million monkeys near it for it, but you're not to tell the police, because I know, in fact we suspected that the police could have been involved, and we'll blow up St. John's and we'll burn the tapestries. Quite frightening. And he gave me a password, Merisi, which is the surname of Caravaggio. He said, I'll phone you next week. In fact, they phoned me the next day, and for 8 months they phoned practically every day, sometimes 3 times a day, and each time I had to invent some excuse, and they would give me till the end of the month, and then they'd give me. I managed to knock down their price to a third of a million, so they thought we were serious. In fact, the minister weren't really interested, so it went on and on. Yes, this is the Polaroid picture with the coffee pot on it, and you can see when they rolled it, and where the highlights are, there's very thick paint, so obviously the paint came off, all right? And then they start, since government didn't take any action, they started sending me bits of canvas, you know, the way they do it. This is the first piece of canvas I received, and it had a special lining at the back, so I could say to the minister, I can swear it's our Caravaggio. Okay, you see, this was a special lining, so I could identify it straight away. Now, we had a young man trying to chase the calls. At that time, we had a very primitive telephone system. You phoned one person and got another, you remember? Anyhow, so after 8 long months, they traced it to a factory, a shoe factory. So I went there, and my driver was from there, so he gave me some information on them. And then I went to the ministry and got the workbook, so I knew who they were. Okay, then we could tell the police. And the police wanted to, there has been a change of government, so the new government, new party wanted to prove that the police were now as pure as driven snow, and they wanted to do it in a big way. Okay? So when should we capture them? Instead of just going and arresting them, they wanted to do it at a Hollywood. Okay, with helicopters, cars, and so on. And that was done. It was done from my office. This was my office at the museum. And I chose the date. I chose the 4th of August, because the 4th of August is traditionally the feast of St. Dominic in Malta. Okay, and we needed that for St. Dominic. Okay? So, okay. So there was a helicopter going round, and I had the policeman next to me. They phoned us, they did every day, and I said, okay, we've got the money, there's a lawyer who'd like to speak to you. So he said, okay, cut off another piece of canvas, put it somewhere, when we find it, we'll give you the money. It's far more complicated than I can tell it. Somehow they suspected that something was going wrong. I mean, it's not every day that we have helicopters going around. So they dropped this piece of canvas. And at one time, they saw the car. This is the policeman, and these are the thieves in that car. So two men were arrested. Unfortunately, one of them was given an overdose and he died, and the other one died soon after, so nobody went to prison. And there was another man involved who had to capture me, and he was given 5,000, promised 5,000 pounds, and the price said, I'll give you another 100 if you keep him. Okay, yeah, so that's taken from the helicopter. And this is the moment that the canvas was found. So here you have all the man who was in the helicopter, the man who was helping me, that's the Minister for Education, the Minister for Justice, and this is the canvas. It had gone to Italy, they couldn't sell it, so when we were phoning each other, I was saying, look, I want a photo with a new Italian newspaper, and then when the Prime Minister said, you can tell them we've got the money, so they said, okay, we'll bring it back. So they sent us a photo with the Malta paper and so on. And this is when they discovered it in the factory. All right, I'll answer questions if you have questions at the end. Right? Yes, and there's the Prime Minister. And this is how we found it. This is the missing bits that I have. If anyone here is interested in the German Caravaggio. Okay. Here you'll notice the damage that was done. And you can see how it was cut off. From the stretcher. Okay, so that's the damage, yes. This is the press, obviously, when we found it. Yes, that's it. Okay, so I managed to convince the Italian embassy to give me a military plane, and I took it to Rome. It was an old plane, there wasn't even a seat, I had to hang on, yes. This is the Caravaggio, okay. That's how I took it to Rome to be restored at the Istituto Centrale. And I had to sign that if something happened to me, I mean, it wasn't my fault, okay? Now, you know, one thing I want to show, this is an enlargement of the head of St. Jerome. This is a restored bit, okay? Now, obviously, you can't see it. What they do when there's a missing part, they fill it with a special plaster, and then they do what is called the tratteggio, or the rigatino. They have very, very fine lines in watercolor, so it can be reversed, and also because watercolor doesn't change as well. Okay, and when you see it at close distance, you know that this part is restored. When you see it on the original, it merges perfectly with the original. Okay, yes, okay, that's in the, that's when it's going back, yes, okay. And now, the other case, Caravaggio, was the beheading, the big beheading. Malta was applying to join Europe, and I think our politicians thought that if we showed our Caravaggio, we are Europeans. So, and it needed restoration too, because someone had gone in and slashed the signature. So again, the Italian embassy came to the rescue. They were very good friends. and they left with the Cassiopeia to take the beheading to Livorno. Okay, yes? Well, those are my sleeping quarters. That's the big Caravaggio. They took it very seriously. The captain got a guard to stand by the Caravaggio day and night, okay, on the ship. Okay, so we arrived at Livorno. It's a great experience. Drove very, very slowly because it's the paint was coming off to Florence. Here it's arriving at the Fortezza d'Abbasso. They are restoring the first cut underneath the signature. Right, that's the first touch of restoration. That's a spring that was used to hold the canvas stretched. It was invented in Rome by the Istituto of Restauro, but it didn't work because it was rusty and so on, so that wasn't a good experiment. Anyhow, those are the restorers. It was restored in Florence, they did a fantastic job, and then it was exhibited. It was exhibited at the Palazzo Vecchio. We had the two other Caravaggios, the knight and the sleeping Cupid on the side. Through the help of Veltroni, who at that time was Minister for Culture, I managed to get it restored in Florence, because Florence for me is first and foremost. As I said, they did a fantastic, yes? So that's going into Florence. That's me leading the truck with the heading into the Palazzo Vecchio. That's going by the Orsa Michele in Florence. That's going up. We had problems taking it up. They had to cut the iron work because it was too big to get through. That's in Palazzo del Sala del Trono. That's how it was exhibited. It was a lovely, lovely place. That's the lovely hall, Sala del where Michelangelo and Leonardo were commissioned to paint battles. And now that is all painted by Vasari. So you can imagine, yes. Okay, that's Veltroni, yes. Okay, yes. That's Knights of Malta celebrating for this. And now that's Prodi who helped us get into Europe. And when it was restored, it was exhibited at the Carmine. The Carmine is a very important church in Florence because it's got a chapel with the works of Masaccio. Extremely important for the Quattrocento. So we have the Masaccio on this side, and we had the Caravaggio on the other with a huge X-ray, the size of the painting. I don't think it's ever been done. Just two X-rays showing all the pentiment, all the changes that we made. Right? Yes, and that's going back, okay. And that's going back into the cathedral. That's one of the restorers. I think that's a happy ending. Yes, okay, what else? That's a lecture in the oratory. Yes, here you see the signature, it's very clear. From the Michelangelo. Right, that's the subject of the lecture. Yes, I think that's all. Oh yeah, that's an old etching, probably representing the defrocking of Caravaggio. It's in the oratory. And the habit was pulled off to show that he had been expelled from the order. Yes? Yes, and originally there was a lunette above it, which we've just restored. It's not a Caravaggio, but it was important because it represented an important battle in Malta. Yes? I think that's all. Okay. Thank you very much for your attention. I want a couple of questions. And make them as difficult as you can. Come on. Yes?
We're talking about painting in Odessa, that version of the Caravaggio.
Yes.
And are you familiar with the story of the stolen Caravaggio and the stolen between two?
I know, yes. Yes, yes.
Could you tell this story?
Well,
I wrote a book about that, 100 years of Italian culture.
I see. If you look up a book on Caravaggio, an old book, you will find that Christ taken in the garden and it's marked Odessa. Because there's a version of it, and that was accepted as the Caravaggio. When Sergio Benedetto, who's a great friend of mine, restored this one in the Jesuits' common room, they said, oh, this is much better, this must be original. There's still a problem about it because they've just discovered another one in Rome, which is very, very good. So you always get these rival attributions and you're never 100% sure what it is. Okay? Now let's answer the questions and then I'll come back to that story. Yes? Come on. Yes, please.
There's two questions asking for you.
Right, good.
One is how do you consider.
You've got the right to ask up to three.
Do you consider that Caravaggio, despite his naughty life, was a religious man, was a man of faith?
Yes, in fact, normally I say that it's not in spite of his bad life, but because of his bad life, he could be more religious than lots of others. Okay? Let's say that as a priest. Okay? Now, the second question.
And the second question is, how much...
You know, because the normal person, the pious person, would just paint angels with... Yeah. Sugar, yeah.
As was eccentric. I mean, in his paintings, he was drawing so many innovative elements.
Yeah.
I mean, the way
characters
were dressed, which are so unconventional, so unorthodox, let's say. Or even the human aspect of Jesus or of the Virgin Mary, which are much more enhanced than the holy and the transcendent aspect of, of Jesus. And so how much controversy, all these elements, which were so unorthodox, let's say, posed at the time in the church?
Well, in fact, a number of them were thrown out of the church. I spoke of the death of the Virgin. I spoke of the Madonna and the pilgrims, all right? The day they were considered unorthodox. You know, the Council of Trent was very strict. They were even, the Council of Trent produced a list of prohibited books.
But it was commissioned.
They were preparing a list of prohibited paintings. Fortunately, they never published it, okay? In the case of Caravaggio, he went against orthodoxy. Nowadays, we know that he was more orthodox than the authorities, right? When he represented Christ as young, when he prayed and so on. But he had very powerful friends. The cardinals, especially Del Monte, especially the Borghese cardinals, were so crazy about Caravaggio. I'll give you one example. They arrested Cavalier d'Arpino. Cavalier d'Arpino was his first master. He worked for him. And they arrested him on a false excuse to take the painting because they thought that he had Caravaggio painting. Right? That is why if you go to the Borghese Gallery in Rome, you get all these Caravaggios. Okay? So they weren't very scrupulous about it, but so long as they got what they wanted. Alright? Yes?
Yeah. My question is about the Renaissance art. Renaissance was supposed to restore the ancient art, and ancient art was supposed to be ancient Rome and ancient Greek.
Right.
And yet the overwhelming majority of the painting which we see from this period are depicting the biblical subjects.
Yeah.
So there is certain incongruity in this particular.
No.
Already. Let me finish. Another thing, in restoring the ancient art or ancient life, you have to be true to the people who live in those days. Now, when you see the majority of this painting, you see these people dressed in the modern clothes. Modern, you mean contemporary to the 15th, 16th century. So it's another incongruity. So the question is, the second incongruity is, was it caused by the fact that these painters or the culture in general had no idea, they didn't know what they were doing, how people actually lived in those days? Was there any kind of literary documents who give the description of how Roman soldiers will be dressing, what kind of weapon they were using, what other people will be walking on the street? And what, I mean, this is all, I always bother me when
I... No, you need not bother me.
Yeah.
The Renaissance, which was one of the greatest periods in human history, and that's my period, by the way. By the way, when we speak about the Renaissance, it's 1400. Here we're talking about 1600, okay? Now let's talk about 1400, the Renaissance, Rinascita, what was the Renaissance? The Renaissance, there was a special city called Florence. It was prosperous because it had the Medici to help. It had just the fall of Constantinople had brought all the manuscripts. There was a revival of learning. Right? Florence was organized in guilds. Okay, they had the Medici had their banks. They had the florin that was worth its worth in gold. They had banks in Bruges and elsewhere. So Florence was the city that, after what was called the Dark Ages, art started again. If you read Vasari, if you read Valery, they say there was an ancient civilization, Greece. Then everything died out, and now there's a rebirth. That's what it was, a rebirth, rinascita. And they tried to interpret the old, the glory that was Greece in their own way. Now let me be careful about this. The Greek classical tradition was important for history on two occasions. In the Renaissance, because Florence tried to do what the Greeks had done in its own way, not in the Grecian way, and then in 1800. In 1800, there was a period that we call the Age of Revivals. Okay, if you go to Paris, you see a church, the Madeleine, which is a Greek temple, right? In 1800, they copied Greece. They measured Greek architecture and they copied it. In Florence, in the Quattrocento, they did not copy the Greeks. They were inspired by the Greeks, right? We know that Donatello, we know that Brunelleschi came to Rome to measure the Pantheon, okay? And people said, look at those mad people, they are looking for treasures. And when Brunelleschi built the loveliest dome in the world, the Dome of Florence, okay? He said, I learned the technique and the musicality of the ancients from the Pantheon. But he didn't copy the Pantheon. Right? When I give you the lecture on the Renaissance of Fra Angelico, and you see the architecture of Brunelleschi, he took parts of the elements of Greek architecture, but he used them in a different way. Okay, he just had a capital, the column, the capital, and then the springing of the arch. Whereas in Greek architecture, you should have the column, the capital, the architrave, the frieze, and the cornice. All right. So they never wanted to copy. That's why they were free to change their own way. And obviously, it was a Christian country. Florence was still not profoundly religious, but you remember Savonarola, you remember the organizations and so on. So obviously they had to represent saints. But when they represented saints, they had to use the anatomy of the Greeks. Right? Michelangelo used to go to, at night, we have this from Vasari, to touch the muscles of a Roman statue. There's a huge male figure with lovely muscles, and Michelangelo used to study anatomy, but he wasn't going to paint a pagan god, he painted the figure of Christ and so on. All right, so they adapted what they thought were the rules and so on in their own way. The Renaissance was not a copy of the Greeks. The 19th century was a copy of the Greeks, a copy of Gothic. All right, here we have a lot of neo-Gothic. All right, Gothic started in 1200. Whereas in 1800 it became the fashion again, neoclassic, neoromantic, neorealist. Somebody's telling me to shut up.
Is there one last question?
One last question. Come make it a different experience. Yes?
If there isn't any.
You've got every right. Yes?
No, just I was wondering about the realism of Caravaggio.
Yeah.
Where does it really come from, according to you? Is it from the school of painting in Lombardy?
Yes. In Lombardy, there was already a school. Actually, that's what I think we have to study, because people speak about his period in Rome, but they forget that Campi was already doing night scenes. Right? So obviously, when he was working as a student, he must have seen these dramatic scenes, these night scenes, and he perfected them in Rome. I mean, we are part of all we've met. Yeah? So all these experiences, you can't really say this is came at that moment. It's a life experience. Okay. Well, thank you very much for your question.
Let's toast to this lecture together. Thank you.